When I was young, the Boston Celtics were the best team in basketball, and they had a point guard named Bob Cousy, who was magical the way some basketball players are, and I fantasized that I would become the next Bob Cousy and be a great professional basketball player. That quickly became clear was not going to work, so by the time I was in high school, I was thinking I might become a priest, although Protestant, or maybe a teacher, or maybe a doctor. And I went to college, still not sure what I would become. So like a lot of, I think a lot of people, going to college was where I explored what it was I wanted to be, rather than, I think it's more common now for people to go and say, I want to do X, teach me how to do it, because they think X will, you know, software engineer or something will make money and be good. But I wasn't interested in making money, so it was more what would feel fulfilling, and it took a while to figure it out. Documentaries changed quite a bit in the last several decades, and you know, when I first started writing about it and when I was a grad student taking classes in documentary, it was something you tolerated the way if you were in another program, you might tolerate having to do 17th century British literature because it's required, but not very interesting. And I think what's happened in the last several decades is an explosion of possibility, so that filmmakers have realized a documentary can use all of the tools a fiction filmmaker can use and make a film that is not only informative about what's happening in the world, but also engaging, entertaining, exciting, dramatic, with a story. And that, I think, is what has led to an enormous explosion of documentaries that are in theaters, on television, entire channels devoted to reality programming, not necessarily reality TV, which is something of a freak show, I think, but documentary in a broad sense. It seemed to me that all the films, in terms of what they can do cinematically, all documentaries use those modes, which, you know, could be voiceover or just observing, or like right now, interviewing and participating of filmmaker and subject. So I don't really have a favorite. I think what interests me is how individual filmmakers mix different modes, usually, and find a structure to their film that works to engage us. So some use voiceover, and then is the minute you decide to do that, there's a whole pile of, a box opens of questions. You know, will it be a male or a female voiceover? If it's male, will it sound like an authority figure that we have to obey, or will it be personal? Will it be the filmmaker, or will it be someone hired to do it? Likewise with observation, if you make a film just observing people, when do you stop? How do you not become a voyeur? How do you show respect? How do you get people to do or say things that you feel are important to the film if you're not interacting with them on camera? So every mode raises challenges, and what interests me is how different filmmakers respond to the challenges that the modes raise. And the film like Last Night with Grizzly Man, the subject, Timothy Treadwell, this man that lived with grizzly bears and thought he was one, had died. So the filmmaker, Herzog, could not interact with him, but he finds ways to virtually interact by using his footage and talking about it and talking to people who knew him. The entire digital revolution, I think, has been beneficial to documentary and to film in general, even though film, as you know, celluloid strips, has almost totally disappeared. But the new forms, as you're suggesting, are very democratic. Almost anyone, anywhere, could use like the cell phone you're holding and make a movie on it with some help on a computer and some software. The challenge, I think, remains exactly what it was in 1895. That is, how do you do that in a way that makes other people want to see what you've done? Home movies are usually deadly to people that don't know your family. And likewise, films that are made now digitally that don't speak to a larger audience usually have the same problems that bad films have always had. But the chance to try involves much less cost and sometimes much less time and effort. So it's easier to start to learn and certainly to share. And I think the challenge, which has always been there, but now it's with a new set of tools, is to find the right audience, people who will want to see your film and enjoy seeing your film. Because if it goes on YouTube or Facebook or somewhere, Vimeo, it's one of probably by this point millions that are out there. So getting to the next step of finding 1,000, 10,000, 100,000, million people who will watch it, that becomes the challenge. Yes, I did come this year to Sibiu to be on the international jury, and almost all of my time so far has been devoted to the jury work. And we saw 9 films ranging from maybe 80, 90 minutes to over 3 hours each, and had some extended discussions. I think, I'm not sure, but it strikes me that the films that come from different regions tend to break down into two types. And the stronghold for one type is definitely the U.S., and that is films that have large budgets. like Ken Burns just did a film on Vietnam that clearly cost millions. There have been films on global warming. There's one here on the men from Raqqa in Syria who are reporting on what ISIS is doing in Raqqa, that they don't have money, but the people that made a film about him, about them, do. So I think some films have a lot of support. They have any kind of music they want. They have what I'd call a slick production value, which is not necessarily good. And many of the films from Eastern Europe and from Asia are much more, and some from the US, are much more personal. They are modest in their production qualities, but they explore an issue, a problem that may be very local initially, like a family struggling in a particular place, but they have resonance. You can see how that family is like many other families. And that's what I think most of us on my jury and the other juries have found most appealing, are the films that are personal, that speak from the heart of the filmmaker, that involve us and engage us in particular times and places, but they vibrate with importance because they address issues that we all share.